felt that their parents were not honorable. They used to tell you, and they would tell you. They would tell you they would tell you the naked truth. And my response to them was, first of all, my response to them was, I'm not here to talk about your parents. I'm here to talk about you. And then I said, the word doesn't say to honor your parents when they're honorable. The word says to honor your parents. And that's the bottom line. The word says to honor your parents. I know as a parent, there's been times when I've been dishonorable, but it really doesn't matter, because the way we, and you know, some of us, and this is very appropriate for grandparents too. But some of us, how we relate to our parents, really provides a foundation on how we relate to everybody. Okay, and especially. If you find people in the workplace that have problems with authority, they probably had problems with their parents, okay? And but the thing about authority is authority brings order to society, and God commands that we recognize our parents' authority over us. God calls us to honor our parents in response to God's redeeming love for us. In the Hebrew, that word honor means to make it weigh a lot. Make it weigh a lot, your father and your mother, so that they may have a long life in the land. If you went back to, that you have a long life in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. And the idea here is that when you honor your parents, you give that a lot of weight in your life, okay? Because are any of you here without sin? No. But God doesn't address that issue in this commandment. What he addresses is he calls on us to weigh our parents as if they are worthy. Okay? He doesn't call on us to decide whether or not they are honorable. He calls on us to honor them. And in honoring them, then, we recognize his authority in our life. We've spoken to this before, but how your relationship with your parents can definitively impact your relationship with God, okay? All right? I've spoken to you before about a pastor I had that had a very bad relationship with his father, and it was hard for him to see God with loving eyes for many years. But God deserves to be the object of our honor. And God wants us to honor other people on his behalf. And who displayed the perfect example of honoring his father? Jesus, okay? As an incarnate human being, did Jesus obey his parents? Yeah, we don't see any indication that he didn't. We see that he submitted to authority. So when we fulfill this commandment by honoring our parents, we are in fact imitating Christ. And if Jesus could set aside his glory and to do as he is, to recognize the authority in his life, then we would do well to do the same. But not only did Jesus give us the example of fulfilling this commandment in regards to honoring parents, he also paid his life. Jesus paid his life for our dishonor, for our sins, okay? I don't know if you've thought about it that way, but throughout his life, Jesus exalted and displayed the attributes of his Father. Jesus loved. Remember what Jesus said on the cross in John 19. What did he say to one of his disciples? He asked him to take care of his mom, remember? So even as Jesus was dying for his mother, he still respected his mother, all right? So if you're a parent, That's why modeling is so important. We should be attempting to model Christ for our children. We should be trying to model Christ for our grandchildren, even our great-grandchildren. It's important for us to allow them to try to see what Christ looks like in us, okay? And, you know, again, at the school district in New Mexico, we used to have a parenting requirement. Our parents were required to come to parenting classes 3 times a semester, and if they didn't come, then the kids couldn't stay in the school. But things like teaching children the way of the Lord. And if you're a grandparent and if your children aren't teaching them, you should be trying to teaching them. You should try to teach them the best you can. In Deuteronomy 6, it speaks to that. Disciplining them, which is a real tough one in today's society. Because if you discipline your children according to the word of God, they might put you in jail. Yeah. That's happening to some parents, but Proverbs speaks to disciplining children. And then, of course, Matthew 7 speaks to how we should provide for our children. But, it's obvious to see how Jesus felt about his mother, okay? Even to his last breath, he was concerned about her welfare. Okay, so we honor God when we honor our parents. The second area we want to look at is that we honor God when we love our neighbors. Living in a way that honors God begins in the home, but then it's supposed to spread out to our other relationships as well. We have to be mindful of other people. And when Jesus was asked, which commandment was the greatest? Do you remember how he summed up the law? He told people to love God with all their heart, soul, and mind, okay? And then to do what? To love their neighbors as themselves. That's in Matthew 22. But and years later, Paul spoke of in Romans 13, which we studied a while ago in our Sunday morning service, he talked about prohibitions against adultery and murder and stealing and coveting things. And then he summed up all of those. He said, if you love your neighbors as yourself, you won't do those things. You can't do those things if you love your neighbor as you love yourself. So, what does loving your neighbor look like?
The lady yesterday gave a good example of how, regardless of what the other person does, we're called to love. So when they slap you in the face, you say, "Hey, how are you doing?" And like, just regardless.
Sin. Yeah. You know who Christians are most often hardest on, don't you? Fellow Christians. Yeah. Kind of like shooting your wounded. And you know, these and as you look at for in 20, 13, 14, 15, 16, says do not murder, don't commit adultery. Talks about not stealing, don't give a false witness. Let's look at those real quickly. Murder is a condemned sin. Why is murder, it should go without saying, but why is murder a condemned sin?
Because it's
Huh?
You've taken the life that God gave.
Amen. Amen. Our humanity is full of tragic instances where humanity strikes down humanity. God prohibits murder, as Karen was saying, because we are to love and value Him as the creator of each life, okay? And we should recognize the worth of each life. We should, when we value things by our own intellect, what does that do? Oftentimes it lessens those things. But when we value things by what we see, how God values those things, then we have a much better perspective about how those things should be thought of. The Word makes adjustments for things like what we would call manslaughter today and things like that. All of those things are addressed in the Word of God. Did you know that? But it also speaks about that if someone commits murder, that they should be subject to capital punishment. And, our legal system in this country has become so jaded. Sometimes it seems like the lawbreakers have more rights than the lawmakers or the law abiders. And Jesus spoke to heart conditions. And really what this is all about is heart conditions, because what Jesus did with the law that was written in the Old Testament, who were the law abiders in the New Testament time? Who were the supreme law abiders in their own mind? Scribes, Pharisees, the members of the Sanhedrin. And in their own mind, they had all these rules and regulations that they would follow. But Jesus said in Matthew 5, as Jesus taught in the Beatitudes, he said this in 5:21 and 22, "You have heard it said to our ancestors," okay, referring, now he refers to the Ten Commandments, "Do not murder, and whoever murders will be subject to judgment. But I tell you," and then he says this, "Everyone who is angry with his brother will be subject to judgment. And whoever says to his brother, fool, will be subject to the Sanhedrin, but whoever says, you moron, will be subject to hell fire." What Jesus does is he takes the rules of the Ten Commandments, which the scribes and Pharisees love to follow, and he says, well, it doesn't matter if you keep those rules. It matters what's in your heart. If you think about doing these sins, and he expounds on this later, but as if you think about these sins, then you are guilty of committing these sins. Okay, is even so. The idea is the Lord doesn't want you to harbor hatred in your heart. Okay, and you know how people most oftenly express hatred that's in their heart? With their tongue. Yeah, with their tongue. They allow that bitterness to generate a thought, which they then verbalize, and with their words then, they inflict harm on other people. So, the next one is don't commit adultery. Kind of, God developed a system for sexual expression, and that was within the confines of a marriage. Our society has just blown that whole thing out of the water nowadays. In fact, in our society, infidelity is often glorified. Yeah, I don't watch situational comedies, but every once in a while, I'm exposed to one of their commercials, And almost all the fathers are buffoons. They haven't got a clue. Either that or they're in a homosexual relationship. There's all these lesbian relationships. And children are continually exposed to those things all the time. And what happens to a child who's exposed to the same picture repetitively? They grow to believe that that's the norm, rather than that's the abnorm. Totally, completely against God's design for the family. And that's why I believe you know, there's not a lot written about the intertestamental period when the Old Testament ends and the New Testament begins. 400 years, long time. And during those 400 years, the Israel was dominated initially by Greece. And we are going the way of the Greeks in America. You know, Greek society at that time not only was very permissive towards homosexuality, they flaunted their homosexuality. It was almost like a badge of courage. They had whole groups of their army were made up of homosexual divisions. Normal sex was considered to be, husband and wife sex was considered, was almost in some ways looked down on. You know, what we've done in America is that we have redefined what marriage is, and you're going to see what that means. Because we're going to have people marrying non-people. Watch. That's the way the Greek society was during that intertestamental period. That was what generated, you know, there was no Sanhedrin. There weren't any Pharisees in the Old Testament. Those sects, S-E-C-T-S, were generated in response to the sinful nature of the Greek society that was dominating Israel at that time, the Jews. So they came up, that was the Jews' answer to that type of society that they were surrounded by and that they were exposed to, because they weren't in charge of their own country. But if you want to raise successful children, if you want your children to raise successful children, then in my mind, the key to that would be to raise those children in an atmosphere of security and an atmosphere of discipleship in following the Lord, okay? And it's an important concept. The eighth commandment says that you're not supposed to steal, okay? And why are people, has anybody here never stolen? Why are people prone to steal?
Greed.
Greed, yeah. For a Christian, it simply means you do not believe in God's provision. What God has for you isn't enough. Jesus spoke to the idea that what God has for you isn't enough in Matthew 6, when he talked about don't build up treasures for yourself on earth, because what happens to them? They all go away to nothing. You know, this time is so temporary. You need to build up your treasures for where? For in heaven, okay? So when we steal, we kind of say, well, God, you really don't know what's best for me. I need to. And that crosses a lot of lines when we use that word steal. It's not only as we think of it, just taking something from somebody. It also, in the business arena, when we cheat to get an advantage on people, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, that idea is very, very, has a very, very broad picture. The ninth commandment forbids us to bear false witness against our neighbors, okay? And God does not like lying lips. There's a theme throughout the Old Testament about lying lips. And we ought to be the kind of people that put away any sort of falsehood like that. And why do people lie? Huh?
To get what they want.
To get what they want, yeah. I used to be a consummate liar.
The more you lie, I think the harder your heart gets.
That would be theologically sound. The more you lie, the harder your heart gets, yeah. Yeah. That's a hard one for new Christians sometimes, to stop lying. Because they get so used to lying, it's hard for them to stop lying. So, And again, in Matthew 5, in the Beatitudes, Jesus said, let your yes be yes and your no be no. And then just roll with the punches what happens from there. But it's by the power of the gospel that we can be remade to love the truth. That's how you avoid lying, is to love the truth, okay? Who was preeminently lied about? Jesus. Jesus was preeminently lied about. Falsely accused. Yes, Gordy.
Yeah, I found for myself a turning point occurred with lying when I found out that exaggeration was part of that. I tend to exaggerate a lot of things, and I've been convicted about that this last few years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's very appropriate, you know, because lying is, usually, the intention of lying is to build ourselves up, to make us look like something that we're not. And, you know, Christ was accused, falsely accused for our sake, and He took that abuse, those lies with him to the cross, and he calls for us, and his Father calls for us then to be truth tellers. And the church should be a truth-telling institution. How do you think, one of the questions on your outline is, how can we cultivate truth-telling in our churches? How can we cultivate truth-telling in our churches? Okay, by telling the truth, by emphasizing the truth, by placing importance on the truth, by being open in our dealings, okay, by expressing our hearts to each other. You know, sometimes telling the truth leads to, can lead to very hard decisions, and it can lead to distasteful situations, but we have to tell the truth, no matter what, so. And then, in the outline, it sticks the essential Christian doctrine, number 5. Do you have that in your outline? Speaks of the Bible being the inspired word of God, containing his special revelation to us, to humanity. And because it is that, the inspired word of God, it's the standard of authority for those of us that call ourselves Christian, because it's truthful in everything that it teaches, and it is the source of our wisdom, and instructs us on how to live our life well and to the glory of God. So submitting to the authority of God's word means that we are to believe and obey God by believing and obeying his word, okay? There can be no submission without obeying the word of God. And then Charles Spurgeon once said this about truth. He said, if you want truth to go around the world, you must hire an express train to pull it. But if you want a lie to go around the world, it will fly. It is light as a feather, and a breath will carry it. Yeah. I've told you before, in the commissary business in the Air Force, I used to have at Davis-Monthan, I had 150 cashiers. On a good day, we would run 36 cash registers all at the same time. And to communicate, that was just the cashier section, but to communicate with that many people was always really hard to do. But so we put out all these memos to illuminate things to people in regards to policy and stuff. And usually if I put out a memo, it would take like 3 or 4 days to get it around to everybody. But I could tell like 3 ladies in the cashier section the same thing, and everybody would know in 24 hours. They were the most effective. And that's not a sexist thing, because there were a couple guys I could tell the same thing to. But those ladies were very adept at spreading the word. And it just gives you an idea of how we desire to communicate sometimes. And then the last one we're looking at this morning is Exodus 20:17. And that's about covetousness, and says not to covet your neighbor's house, their wife, their slaves, their animals, anything that belongs to your neighbor. What is covetousness? Wanting what somebody else has?
Jealousy.
Excessively being preoccupied with something that's not yours. Really, I think the 10th commandment covers the ones in front of it. If you think about it, kind of an umbrella. If you don't covet, then you probably aren't going to do those other things, okay? Why does somebody lie to be built up in the eyes of somebody else? And that's, you just want to be somebody you're not. You want to be important. That's kind of like coveting, okay? You covet a desire to be important. Paul, look at Philippians 4, Mary, verse 11 to 13. What does Paul say? Philippians 4, it should be Philippians 4, yeah. I don't say this out of need, for I have learned to be content in whatever circumstances I am. Go ahead. I know both how to have a little, and I know how to have a lot. In all circumstances, I have learned the secret of being content, whether well-fed or hungry, whether in abundance or in need. Keep going. I am able to do all things through Him who strengthens me. Now that's a picture of somebody that has defeated covetousness, okay? But go back a chapter and look in chapter 3 of Philippians, and you'll see in 3:12, you'll see, he says, not that I have already reached the goal or am already fully mature, but I make every effort to take hold of it, because I have also been taken hold of by Jesus Christ. Keep going. Brothers, I did not consider myself to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, I forget what's behind me, and I reach forward to what is ahead. And one more verse. I pursue as the goal the prize promised by God's heavenly call in Christ Jesus. What Paul is saying is he learned that Paul was able to figure out that your contentment, your happiness, your security shouldn't have nothing to do with how much you have, okay? Or for that matter, in any other circumstance. So how do we find true contentment? Pardon me?
Peace in the Lord,
okay. I think what Paul would say is, whenever I yearn of something from of myself, I try to change that yearning to something of Christ. Okay? Let Christ be your goal line, not the other things of life that the world wants you to see as your goal line. What's really important? You know, you don't want to get 30 years down the road and look back and say, why did I pursue those things so vehemently when those things were of such transitory importance? You want to pursue a life that glorified God, and the sooner you make up your mind, I think the more content you will be. John Piper, John Piper's a good writer that I look at his comments oftentimes online, and he said, God is most glorified when we are most satisfied in him. God is most glorified when we are most satisfied in him. Are you satisfied in God today? Or do you need something different? Do you need more? Because if you need more, I'm not sure where you're going to find it. God should be enough, okay? So how we live with others and value others is a reflection on Christ's presence in our lives. And, the Ten Commandments aren't simply a list of don'ts. They are an expression of Christ transforming us into citizens of his heavenly kingdom. And by our relationships, we have an opportunity to glorify God, to live for God, and to glorify God. Contentment simply means wanting what God wants for us rather than what we want. And thus, if we are satisfied with God, as John Piper says, then we can glorify him in our lives. Okay. Comments? All right. We made it. 1 hour down, one to go. It's time to go gargle with hot water and salt. All right, let's stand.